if you've ever spent any time at all working in a wood shop or working on different types of shop machinery, you'll have seen these. They're used all over the place. They're basically a tensioning or clamping knob. In this case, it's got a threaded insert. Threads in and holds something tight. The problem is, these two are salvaged, and I didn't need them with threaded stems. I'm building some shop jigs, and I needed some that would fit onto threaded rods that already existed. These, I went and priced. I don't feel like spending $3 to $5 a piece at a local hardware store. Even ordering them online, you have a limited selection of size and so on, and you still are spending about $2.50 a piece. Then you've got to pay for shipping. I decided there had to be a better way, so I went out on YouTube. I looked at a couple of videos, and inspired by what I found, mostly from a man named Jack Houweling, I think I'm saying his name right, wonderful, wonderful woodworking resource. I'll put a link in the description to his channel, but he had a little video on how to make shop-made knobs. These are mine for my different jigs, and I'm going to show you how I made them. It was a little bit more dramatic and involved than I thought at first, so I hope you enjoy the ride. Right, got the shop vacuum hooked up to the DeWalt chop saw to minimize the dust, so let's trim some pieces. Okie doke. This is going to be part of one jig, and this is going to be part of the knobs for another. Okay, what do you do when you've got, in this case, it's a piece of wooden curtain rod that I'd salvaged from a dumpster dive. What do you do when you have a dowel and you need to drill something down the center, but it doesn't already have a center hole? Well, here's one way to do it. Take a pair of calipers and measure this, and it's not perfectly round, but it's plus or minus 1.4 inches. Close enough. So that tells me the center is going to be at 0.7 inches. So to get there, I'll go ahead and crank my dial calipers down to 0.7 inches. Set the calipers down and take a little beam compass, and I'm just going to set that, crank that down to match. If I take, and normally you put the point of the compass at the center and draw your circle, but in this case, I'm going to put my point right on the edge and strike a curve, rotate a bit, put the point right on the edge, try not to stab myself in the finger, draw a curve, and I'll check it a third time. Where those all cross, that is my center line. I'm going to redrill with the larger quarter inch bit I need to make room for these quarter 20 bolts that I'm using for everything. These are the long ones for my tapering jig, and then the shorter ones are for use. These guys are the ones I'm using on the featherboard jig. Over there. Okay, well, it's been a bad week. I've gotten almost nothing done. My wife has been sick, and I've been running after her. I feel like complete poo-poo doo-doo. So I've got nothing done. Not any work, not anything here in the garage, but I can't stand it anymore. It's Friday. I got to get some things done. One of the things I needed for it was a knob to tighten this adjustable block that slides in the slot. One of the things that I'd scavenged in an earlier video that I think I'd shown was some of this red curtain rod that somebody had thrown in the trash. So I baloney cut some pieces off the end. Really what these are intended for is as a spacer. What I'm going to do for some of the larger knobs is cut a piece out of this. This is part of a 2x4, or this may have been a 2x6, that I jointed and then sliced lengthwise in pieces. So I then sliced it in half on the table saw, and I'm going to use this to make the knob handles. And there's an interesting thing about the geometry of a circle. That if you scribe a circle with like a beam compass, and I don't remember what dimension these are. I actually traced these out on a paint can lid using a paint can lid instead of a compass. But if you draw a circle with a compass, right, and then just pick a point, doesn't matter where, put the tip, the pointer tip down, and then strike on the outside circumference, right, and then move down, strike on the outside circumference, move down, strike on the outside circumference, move down. You end up with six equal divisions. It's very peculiar the way geometry works. But these now, I had to fudge it a little here, but these darker lines are where I'm going to use a Forstner bit. That's going to be my center drill point for the Forstner bits. So essentially, I'm going to drill out these cavities, right? Half semicircles, I guess they are. Sorry, my brain is not working and I feel like crap. But once I've drilled those out, then I'll go through and touch these on my little column sander that fits in the drill press to smooth them out and round these edges over, and that should make a nice knob. And originally what I planned was the little baloney cuts from the curtain rod will then get glued on here. And what will happen is you'll drive in a T-nut into the baloney cut, and then that will get epoxied into the larger knob, right? So this becomes the base of your knob, and then your whatever bolt that you're going to be threading onto just sticks down through, threads into that. However, on this jig, there just simply isn't enough room to fit those larger knobs. And I didn't want to use a wing nut, so what I'm going to do is drive this in, and then this will become my tightening knob for this piece. And we'll see how that works out. I'm not planning on doing anything to the edge to make any cute little grip edges. If it turns out I can't get a good grip on this to tighten it, I can add something later. But that's what I'm up to. And then start it in the hole. And I'm going to do this with a pair of pliers, or otherwise I'll end up smashing my fingers. Oh, where are my pliers? I put everything away to get this together. So I take my hammer pliers, loosen them out. Just a beater pair I've got. I don't even know where I got these. Give it a hold, and then just give it a tap down in with a hammer. And that seats the tangs down in. Started on there. Oh, please tell me I put the right T-nut in. Yeah, here we go. Yep. I really need a washer in there. So I'll get a fender washer and put behind it. But yeah, that tightens down really well. And I don't even have to do anything other than hold the backside of the bolt, the head of the bolt, with my finger. And here we see the reason why it might not have been a great idea to make these out of pine. I gave it a couple more whacks with a hammer, and it split apart where the tangs bit into the wood. So, what to do? I don't have any hardwood. I don't want to buy any hardwood for this. I'm going to have to tap this all back apart. And go back, step back, and rethink this. Okay, we're going to try another experiment here. I have chopped another piece with a center hole that I'll have to widen a bit off of that curtain rod. And I've scribed out a smaller circle on a piece of scrap. I think this is still some of that 5/8 plywood I'm burning through. As you can see, it's almost the same size, but this should give me some standoff space. But what I'm going to do is drive that T-nut into this, which should resist all the splitting, and I will put a little bit of a countersink on this guy, and then I'll end up epoxying it, I think, over top, and that'll create a standoff, and then this will act as my handle. But what I'm about to do now is, using a quarter-inch Forstner bit, I'm going to drill some circles here, all the way around the circumference, it's a 3/8, and I'm also going to punch a center hole so that the bolt can stick through if necessary, but we're going to give this a try and see what happens. Right, so I've cut my center hole and I've cut my perimeter holes. Now I'm just going to throw it up here on the bandsaw and join on the curve around the circle. Looks like the plywood has come apart a bit. Nice, screw you. And this is why you should use good quality plywood, not the crap I am using. But we'll give it a whirl and see what happens. Okay, first test seemed to work. I tapped in the T-nut. I'm now spreading some PL300 polyurethane adhesive around the outer edge of this standoff, I guess you call it. Trick is not to get too much. You don't want to plug up the hole where the bolt comes through. But I do want to get some. I took a Forstner bit and I cut an inset countersink down into this, holding it with a pair of my hammer pliers here on the drill press, and very lightly, very gently drilled in. But I do want enough to kind of squish around the T-nut and really lock it in there. And I've hogged out the center hole just a little bit more, very, very roughly, using a bit on hand drill. No magic. Okay. And then all I'm going to do is throw a clamp on there. And then I can polyurethane this later. And then the next step after that will be cutting some more of these pieces of dowel. I'll probably toss this one and re-drill and do a better job of getting it centered to form the standoff for the knob. But that's where things are. So next to the drill press. So you make Swiss cheese. Yep, I've officially made Swiss cheese. So now we are going to do, I'm just going to cut out one on the bandsaw real quick and see what that looks like. Let's go trim one of these out. So if this is Swiss cheese and I'm cutting it, am I cutting the cheese?
Okay, I've gotten three of the knobs rough cut. And being the cheap bastard that I am, you remember my little boo-boo over there when I was doing the drilling and I realized I had my layout too close together. Well, I figured out if I kind of weasel things around a little and remark where I want these drill-out sections to be, I can actually salvage this piece. So I've marked it, and I'm now going to punch it on the new points around the circumference of the circle, and I'm going to drill it there. Means I'll expand this hole, and I'll expand this hole, and I'll get my four knobs, damn it. Haha! Did it. Okay, so I got four knobs to begin with. As long as I'm on a roll here, I'm going to go ahead and rough cut the tops of these other ones just to get it done. It's easier to do batch operations in a hurry. I've already got the knob for this, and it's a little bit ugly, but it is functional, and that's really all I care about. And I didn't have to spend $2 or $3 or whatever the heck the hardware store wanted to charge for those molded plastic knobs with the nut insert. And I won't have to for these either. And these will actually be easier to use once I get done sanding them. So. Yeah,
Doesn't have to be perfect, just soften the edges a little bit. That'll work. Only 7 more to go. So I've got to get a T-nut and give it a tap and then drill some pre-sinks for the tangs so I don't risk splitting this. Yeah, I think that's going to work. And a little bit of spray paint those black. I think they'll look okay. Let's see what's left. I got to do some countersinking and some drilling for the T-nuts and then drilling of center holes and epoxy that in. And I have to build a little, well, I don't have to build one, I have one. That is going to be my corner brace for the drill press. So once I get this lined up, I'm going to clamp this guy down and then I can just slap these in and drill the center hole. So we're going to go with that. Okay, I've clamped up my platform here and I've got that little angle piece and I've test aligned this one of the little dowel pieces that I'm using as the offset. And it, all I gotta do is wedge it, hold it in the corner, punch through, and that's repeatable and almost dead center. Okay, that worked. Okay, ream this hole out. Now, I'm going to be using quarter-inch bolts, but this is a 9/32 bit because the thickness of the well on the T-nut has to be able to fit down in there. First thing I'm going to do is set it on the surface. I'm not going to pound it in, I'm just going to give it a gentle tap. And that marks the point where all of the tangs are going to get driven into the wood. Actually, I'm doing this backwards. Glad I'm talking this through. Thanks for help. I really need to countersink these because I want this to be below the surface of the main knob body, and then these spacers are going to glue on top of that because I don't want to drive them down in this. They will end up splitting.
Yeah, let me go ahead and get out the Forstner bit and then countersink.
Okay, really scientifically, I figured out that if I use a 5/8 inch Forstner, it's slightly larger than the T-nut itself. So that gives me a little bit of wiggle room. Okay, I don't need this to be very deep. Just enough to offset the thickness. That'll work. This one's gonna suck because I've already drilled out the center hole. You know what? I'm gonna drill through this and use this as a drilling guide. Now, what was the point of that, you ask? Well, if I'm cautious and I center up my hole on the other one, I can now use this as a drill guide and have a properly centered countersink around the larger hole that I'd already drilled. I don't like doing it this way, but I was a dope and I already drilled that one center hole, so this will help. Yeah. Okay, dope. Now I'm done with the Forstner bit. Ow, that's hot. It's a little warm. Friction and all that jazz. Who'd have thunk it? Alright. Time to drill these the rest of the way through. There we go. Next step is going to be gonna tap these, and based on where the tangs are, I'm gonna drill a couple of very tiny diameter holes. Yeah, there we go. That's a little better. Sorry. And that should be enough. Just darken these a little. All right, time to tap the other ones, and then I'll just drill them all in one shot. Okay. This is why you don't beat on them really hard. It's one of the problems. I'm using this scrap 2x4 material that I've cut and shaped and milled and so on, and pine just is really not structurally strong stuff. And when you whack on it, you can split it. I should be using a hardwood with a dense grain, but I really don't have any. And I'm trying to do all of this on the cheap right now. And it won't ultimately matter. Once I get the T-nuts glued in, when you spread out the load across the surface of that, it's not a big deal. It's only when you focus the load on a given area that you run into the weakness. So what we're going to try now is I've squeezed out some epoxy. Excuse me, not epoxy. Polyurethane construction adhesive. And what I'm going to do is pack some around here to glue the T-nut in place, and I'm also going to be gluing on the dowel spacers. I hope that's coming across okay. I ended up spackling over most of the holes, but I left one of them open as a alignment hole. Now, rather than risk splitting these, I'm going to gently tap it into place. I'm not going to whack it like I did before. That's what I'm looking for. The only thing I gotta do is be careful when mating these together. Okie dokie. Take a couple of my clamps that are out there. If you can see this, I'm making sure this is all aligned by threading it down onto these carriage bolts. And then I'm just going to put a couple of spring clamps on either side. And I've made the world's biggest wing nut! Woohoo! Just going to repeat that with a couple more of these using a caution, because I really don't want to split any more of these handles apart. Here we have my wing nut collection. These are drying. Again, pre-drilling those very carefully to prevent the tangs on the T-nuts from splitting seems to have worked. The drill size I used for these four tang T-nuts was a 7/64. And like I'd mentioned earlier, the using pine as a knob is probably not the best. You should use a dense grain hardwood or a plywood. Like on the little knob back here, I just used a chunk of the plywood, and it's much more resistant to splitting and so on. But again, I've got all of this junk 2x4 material, and I got to use it. And I think this will work. Most of the tension is going to be borne by the T-nut and the wood in compression on the bottom of that little piece, the red dowel there, when I clamp down the clamp blocks. So I think that'll work. There's really nothing I can do right now. This glue has got a cure. Given how frickin' cold it is, it's probably in the 50s here in the garage, maybe mid-50s. It's 30 outside. This is going to take a while to cure, so I'm just going to leave these. But that's where things are. I am pretty happy with this. Once these are glued up, and I'll go ahead and put the finishing touches on the rest of the knobs here. A little bit of time, a lot cheaper than spending. I priced these out for knobs this big. They're $3.22 or something at the local hardware store, and that's insane. Plus, with making them, I can make them to where this is any size that I want.
I can make them bigger, I can make them smaller, etc. So, back later once this is cured up. Right, to keep everything aligned, that's why I'm using the carriage bolts as kind of holders to float the homemade knobs, and then putting the clamps on. And because I have 7 knobs, I had to kind of get creative with my stacking here. And I also have a limited number of clamps, so these two I put face to face. Nothing to do now except a little bit of cleanup and move on to other projects, because those have got to cure at least overnight.
Have you played with your knobs today? Yeah, that's a loaded question. So here is the knob array that's been drying overnight. Let me get rid of some of the profusion of clamps here to make it a little less confusing. What I'm doing now that they're all dried, I'm going to give them a light sanding, including the little red standoff or face sections. And I picked up some cheap crap spray paint at the home center. Black, because black hides flaws, and it was the only color they had for 97 cents a can. So I'm going to sand these down, spray paint them black, and then probably slap on a coat of the polyurethane over top of that to protect it and seal it. Yeah, that glue has hardened overnight, and it is pretty much rock hard now. So I think those are going to work fine. That is not a pizza box and a dumpster dive tote. This is a redneck paint booth. The problem I have is some of these spray paints, you end up with grody, black, nasty-looking fingernails forever. So we're going to bend you over for the exam. Okay, it looks like the knob job is complete. Sorry. I couldn't resist. All of the knobs have been polished. No, that doesn't sound good either. I finished all of the polyurethane has dried on the shop-made knobs. I'm probably going to get in trouble if I put this up, but I may do it anyway just for a laugh. Yeah, I coated the tops with polyurethane. I didn't bother with the bottoms because that's a wear surface. Mostly, I just, wherever they're going to get handled, I wanted a little bit slicker finish. Now, these, I could have done a much better job. You can see how uneven it is and the lumps and bumps and so on. But again, they're shop-made knobs. Don't really care. But they're big. They're easy to get threaded on and started. They're not little bitty wing nuts you gotta fart around with. They work pretty well. So I'm pretty happy with how they came out. I've got one extra basically. I made 2 for the tapering jig. I've got 2 for the different feather boards. And now I just gotta find a place to stash these where they're handy but not underfoot. Show off. These look pretty good. They work pretty good. Let me take this over to the table saw and show you. They lock in place such that back pressure here can't kick the piece out. Crank down on those. I can get a lot more force on those with this big knob. Yeah, that's not going anywhere.
That concludes the video.
I hope that encourages you to give it a try. Again, I don't suggest using pine for these like I did, although I've made it work. Use a nice plywood. This isn't a nice plywood, but I made this knob out of plywood. And the T-nut is actually driven into the knob body itself. And that's true for these as well. The T-nut tangs are driven up into the knob body, not the circular face piece.
So I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned. I got plenty more videos coming. And hopefully in the next couple, you'll see this overcrowded pigsty get turned into a proper garage shop.